Hello, my name is Joanne Bailey Boersma, and this is the WKTV Journal. The new year always seems to bring in changes, and within the first week of 2021, Degage Ministries announced a big change. Longtime executive director Marge Palmer-Lee has announced her retirement at the end of the month, with Thelma Ensink posed to take the helm of the organization that provides services and items to those who are homeless and in need. Thelma joins us today to share her Degage story and vision for the organization. Welcome, Thelma.
Thanks for having me.
Well, I'm so glad to have you. I'm just talking to you in the last little bit. It's been just an amazing journey. I'd like to start a little bit about, you are actually originally from South Africa.
That's right.
So tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah. So I was born and lived till I was about 12 years old in Pretoria, South Africa. And this was during the 70s and 80s, during apartheid. So really from the youngest age, I just felt ignited in me, you know, a passion for social justice, because I grew up around racial injustice. And then moved to the United States, and then after moving here, went on to, I was at Highland Christian Schools, and then went on to Calvin University. And while I was there, someone said to me, why don't you try being a paramedic and supporting yourself through school by being a medic? So I would go to Calvin during the day and then to Davenport University to become a paramedic at night. And loved that. I ended up working for American Medical Response for 15 years in downtown Grand Rapids as a paramedic.
Well, that was an amazing journey. Can you tell us a little bit? I mean, so you grew up in South Africa at a time when there was apartheid.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit about that experience?
Yeah. So from the youngest age, you know, you just have this environment around you where you're completely separated, completely segregated. So Native African people were not allowed to go to our schools, were not allowed to be in our churches, were not allowed to have bank accounts, had to leave at the end of the day on buses to go back to the homelands. And so it was just very clear, that discrimination. They really were treated as less than human. And that's the kind of rhetoric that was being used. That's what I grew up around. I was lucky that my parents really pushed against that. They were part of a movement that said, you know, this isn't right. This isn't the way that we want our world to be. So I had those lessons instilled in me at a very young age, but it was really a difficult time to grow up in that kind of environment.
Mm-hmm. Was it much of a culture shock once you came from South Africa to the United States?
Yes, so South Africa is a much more formal culture. Mm-hmm. So as a teenager, moving from there to here, you know, I just really didn't know how to behave like an American teenager. So it was really hard, and English was my second language. Mm-hmm. So I had to get used to speaking English all the time, and just didn't know, you know, how to dress and how to behave. So even though I come from a position of privilege, I can certainly relate and understand people who immigrate to the United States and how difficult it can be to try to assimilate into culture.
Mm-hmm. So I want to kind of, I guess, jump a little bit forward. You ended up becoming, and I'm so fascinated by you, you ended up becoming a paramedic,
mm-hmm.
Working in downtown Grand Rapids,
mm-hmm.
With, well, I mean, we say marginalized or people with challenges.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about how that impacted your life.
Yeah. So working for American Medical Response in downtown Grand Rapids, you know, we would run calls and care for people of all different backgrounds. Particularly what moved me was picking up patrons from places like Degage Ministries and carrying them in the ambulance to the hospital or providing care for them and learning that their story wasn't unlike my story, that in many ways they were living lives just like mine until there was a tragic event or traumatic event, or maybe they served in the military, and then that sent their life into a very different course. And all of a sudden they find themselves experiencing poverty or being without a home, being without the resources and relationships that they need to really be in a stable place. And so that was really moving for me, and that's something that stuck with me beyond that, and as I went into other, you know, parts of my career, but that was the first time I really interacted with the patrons of Degage Ministries.
Mm-hmm. And now I understand, because you actually ended up going, you said, to Ionia to work in a rural medical facility.
That's right.
And so that opened you to a whole different level.
Yeah.
Of challenges.
Right. Yeah. So I got to know what it's like to be a vulnerable population in downtown Grand Rapids, but then moving out to Ionia and working there in a medical facility, you really got to see what poverty looked like more in our rural setting and some of the challenges that many of the people faced there, as well as some of them didn't have access to the education or to the other kinds of resources that they needed. So that was, again, another really impactful time in my life.
Mm-hmm. Now, then you made a sudden switch, as I noticed when I was reading through your bio. You ended up going into education.
That's right. So my husband and I were youth leaders while I was a paramedic and then later working at the medical practice, and just spending time with these young people and being able to share with them my stories of growing up in South Africa, my stories of working in these different environments. It really struck me that students didn't always have a wide perspective about how other people live or how some of the challenges that others face. And so I became passionate about becoming an educator to widen students' perspectives and to help inspire them to become citizens who want to make a change in their community, want their world to be a better place. So I decided to become a social studies teacher and started teaching history and social studies at the high school level.
Mm-hmm. And it led to, and I was so surprised when you told me, but it led to the development of that ambassadors program over at Calvin Christian High School, be careful there, which is an incredible program in itself. And what gave you tell me a little bit about that program, and what gave you the idea to do this?
Yeah, so as I was a teacher, one of the things I noticed is, not all students learn in the same way. Mm-hmm. Not all students feel inspired or energized to learn. And so Ambassador High really came from this idea of, how do we help students to see how their learning connects to the outside of the classroom? As a teacher, students used to say, why do we have to learn this? And you kind of get a little annoyed when a student asks that. But really, students have a right to ask that. Why do we have to learn this? How does this connect to the world outside of the classroom? And so Ambassador High was born out of that, where we have our students go out into the community and work in internships. So 3 days a week, they are in the classroom, taking the classes that they need to build that strong foundation. But then 2 days a week, they're out in the community, and they're working right alongside of professionals, learning those professions. And then when they go back into the classroom, they're feeling more inspired to learn some of those basic subjects, because they're now seeing how those subjects connect to the world outside of those walls.
And the type of positions or type of jobs that they would do?
So there's a wide range, and this really surprised me when I first started seeing schools like this pop up around the country, because Ambassador High is not alone. Mm-hmm. There's big picture schools all around the country. So it can be anything from medical to office to manufacturing. It could be really anything. And we found out that there's all kinds of ways in which we can safely put students in those places. Mm-hmm.
So how long have you been at Calvin Christian Schools?
So I was there for 6 years. Mm-hmm. And just finished my time there at the end of July.
Mm-hmm. Now, was it with the idea that you were going to go into something nonprofit, or were you just looking for a change? I mean, what led to this?
Yeah, so while I was a teacher, I got very interested in serving administration. So I became middle school principal, and then a high school principal, and then eventually a head of school. And when you're a head of school in the private schools and the Christian schools, you are really a nonprofit leader. You're meeting with donors, you're managing a large organization with multiple employees and a budget. And so it's really very similar to the nonprofit world, and you have a very clear mission that you want to live out. But while I was serving in education, I just kept feeling a calling in my heart, a calling by God, to say that I don't just want to teach about the most vulnerable populations. I want to have that opportunity once again, like I did early in my career, to walk directly with the most vulnerable populations. And so really about over the last 2 years, I felt that call become stronger and started to get really interested in wanting to serve in a nonprofit that directly walks with these populations.
Mm-hmm. Now, had you heard about Marge possibly retiring?
No, that was a surprise. I just knew that I wanted to work in that field, so kind of took a step of faith, mm-hmm. stepping away from the education world and really seeking the right opportunity. Marge is such an amazing lady. She really is just an icon in the Heartside community, and so you kind of think she's never gonna retire, always gonna be there, because she's just so important and woven into that fabric. But when I did hear about that position opening up, I thought, this is just the right fit. This is the kind of organization that I want to serve for this next chapter in my career.
Now, you had already had some experience with Degage. Mm-hmm. You talked a little bit about being a paramedic and taking people mm-hmm. to Degage. Tell us a little bit more about how you got involved with Degage.
Yeah, so Degage Ministries is just a wonderful place. It is just a place of joy, and I had the opportunity to intersect with it a few times over the years. So first, like I said, as a paramedic, just seeing how patrons were just treated with dignity and respect, and how it really is a place that stabilizes them and then connects them to those resources that they need. And then I got to interact again with them as an educator as we took groups of students over there to do service projects, to take tours, to learn. Some of our interns can go there and work from Ambassador High. So I just really had an opportunity over the years to interact with Degage in different ways, and each time that I did, just really drawn to that place.
Well, you're stepping in at quite a challenging time because, yeah. You know, with COVID, we've seen an absolute increase. And as you've mentioned before, I mean, something can just really trigger people to having to change and be in a situation where they're facing these challenges. Thoughts or ideas of how you're going to go forward?
Yeah, I mean, that is our most immediate challenge, is continuing to keep our patrons safe and continuing to keep our staff safe. You know, one of the things we love to do most at Degage is have community events and do things where our patrons can build relationships with each other and with our volunteers and with our staff. And that's been really challenging during this time. So we're mostly focused on meeting those immediate needs, but we are just so ready and so excited for when we can welcome our volunteers back, when we can have some more of those community events. So right now, we're really in that planning phase of how do we do that in the short term, and then hopefully as the COVID numbers go down and become safe again, to be able to do that more longer term. So that's our most immediate thing that we're trying to address. But like you said, the needs are just continuing to go up. More and more people are facing unemployment, evictions, poverty, homelessness. So really partnering with the area organizations and partnering with community partners and saying, what is Degage's work to do? What is some of the other organizations' work to do? So that we can make sure that those needs are met.
Mm-hmm. Now, during this time, though, Degage has had programs operating and open. Available. Can you talk a little bit about some of the things that have been available for people?
Yeah, it just really wasn't a choice for us as an essential service to close down. We were going to find a way to be available. So we are still serving our meals, but we have to do it a little bit differently. We have to make sure we're social distancing. We have to make sure we're wearing masks and we don't have food, so we're doing that a little bit differently. We are still offering our ID services and our resource office, but again, having to put some procedures in place, and we can't have as many people in the building at the same time as usual. And then our women's emergency shelter, our open door, we've had to put some restrictions in and figure out how we can make that work. And we've had great community partners at times when some of our patrons have tested positive, working with area hotels to be able to put them in isolation and in shelter there. So we've had to adapt. We've had to be creative. But we have a staff that's just dedicated, and they're tired. They're working many long hours. But I'm just so proud of the ways that they've been able to adapt.
Mm-hmm. So what would you tell people if they are experiencing this? I mean, what's the best way to connect with agencies?
Yeah, I think you just come to our agencies. You just come to, to Degage Ministries and connect with us, and we will take it from there. You know, so I always say we stabilize people. We say, what's your most immediate need? Making sure you have shelter, making sure you have food to eat today, and then we're going to connect you to those appropriate resources. So you really can come to any of our organizations, and we'll help you connect to the right place.
Mm-hmm. And what about needs? I mean, anything the public can do to support Degage?
Yeah, so we always welcome donations from the community. So particularly during the winter months, we love to have those warm items so that people can have what they need. Financial gifts are so appreciated because then we can funnel them to the places that we need to, because we have had to acquire more staff, and we have had to, like I said, put people in spaces where they can be isolated. So those financial gifts are always so welcomed, and we are so blessed that we have such a generous community here in Grand Rapids that's always willing to love us and always willing to help out. So we just want to say thank you to everyone who's been partnering with us. And there's always ways for you to partner. So check out our website or give us a call, and you know, we can kind of tell you what some of the latest needs are.
Mm-hmm. So I guess then lastly, I mean, any vision that you have for Degage at this point? I mean, they've done a lot of growth over the years. As you said, Marge has been an incredible leader. Right there on the forefront. Any parting thoughts?
Yeah, so Marge has built an incredible team and really set us on a great course. We broke ground just a few weeks ago mm-hmm. on our new building project on our expansion. So when that's completed, which we hope is at the end of this year or beginning of next year, we are so excited that we're going to be able to expand our dining services, expand our hygiene program. We're going to be offering a respite center where currently people who are experiencing homelessness often can't have surgeries that they need because there isn't a place to recuperate. So we're going to be able to offer that. We're going to be able to offer some third shift sleeping, expand our women's shelter, and for the first time be able to house some women with children as well. So we are right now very busy, even in the midst of COVID, planning for the programming that we're going to need to support that expansion. So we're very excited about that.
And I just want to let our audience know that, you know, third shift sleeping, for those who don't know, it's somebody who works on third shift and they have to sleep yes. during the day, which my husband did for years, and I know how hard that can be to find yes. a spot. So
yes, yeah. And there really just hasn't been a place to support that. So we're so excited that we're going to be able to do that. So mm-hmm. looking forward to finishing that project.
Well, maybe when you get that open up, we can have a chance to have a little mini tour and
that
bring that
great.
To our audience. So we'd really appreciate that.
We'd love to have you. That'd be wonderful.
Great. Well, Thelma, thank you so much for being here today. We really appreciate you. And welcome to the team at Degage. We look forward to all the things you're going to be doing.
Thank you so much. Thanks so much for having me. It's always a pleasure to share. Thanks so much.
Mm-hmm. We thank our guest, Thelma Ensink, the new executive director of Degage Ministries, for being with us today. To learn more about Degage and its programs, visit degageministries.org. If you are a person in need or know of someone who is, please call or text 211. By doing so, you will be connected to an array of services offered in Kent County. I'm Joanne Bailey-Borsma, and this has been the WKTV Journal. The WKTV Journal is produced by volunteers from our community. To join our team of writers and television crew members, contact us at 616-261-5700, email managing editors Joanne Bailey-Borsma or Ken Norris, or visit WKTVjournal.org. Thanks for watching.